Greetings. Hello, hello. Happy March. Happy Women's History Month. My name is Diana Vega, and I am the Civic Engagement Coordinator for DC Public Library. And we want to thank you for joining us today for what promises to be a wonderful program. This program is kind of, it's twofold. It's for Women's History Month, but it's also part of the Our City, Our Story series that I've been leading, where we do two programs a month. One program focuses on local government or governance issues, and the other program is a literary event that features an author or authors who are from DC or who write about DC and the DMV area. And so tonight I'm so excited to have Sadeqa Johnson, author of The Yellow Wife, recently released book The Yellow Wife, and Marita Golden, who is an acclaimed author in her own right. And so Sadeqa Johnson has written Yellow Wife. She is an internationally best-selling author of four novels. Her accolades include being the recipient of the National Book Club Award, the Phyllis Wheatley Award, and the USA Best Book Award for Best Fiction. She is a Cambilio Fellow, former board member of the James River Writers, and a Tall Poppy writer. Originally from Philadelphia, she currently lives near Richmond, Virginia, with her husband and three children. Marita Golden is an acclaimed author, a cultural literary activist, a master writing teacher, a creative writing coach, and so much more. She attended public schools in Washington, D.C. and graduated from American University and the Graduate School of Journalism at Columbia University. She's been a faculty member in MFA creative writing programs at George Mason University, Virginia Commonwealth University, and many others. She has lectured and taught internationally. Her articles and essays have been published in the New York Times, the Washington Post, and Essence. And as a literary activist with Clive McElvin, she co-founded the Zora Neale Hurston Richard Wright Foundation that has been supporting the international community of Black writers for three decades. So we're so excited that they will be in conversation together to talk about Sadeqa Johnson's newest novel, Yellow Wife. It is a historical novel, and I'm just going to give you all a brief synopsis. They're going to get into way more details. But born on a plantation in Charles City, Virginia, Phoebe Dolores Brown has lived a relatively sheltered life, shielded by her mother's position as the estate's medicine woman and cherished by the master sister. She is set apart from the others on the plantation, belonging to neither world. She's been promised freedom on her 18th birthday, but instead of the idyllic life she imagined with her true love, Essex Henry, Phoebe is forced to leave the only home she has ever known. She unexpectedly finds herself thrust into the bowels of slavery at the infamous Devil's Half Acre, a jail in Richmond, Virginia, where the enslaved are broken, tortured, and sold every day. There, Phoebe is exposed not just to her jailer's cruelty, but also to his contradictions. To survive, Phoebe will have to outwit him, and she soon faces the ultimate sacrifice. So then the novel sounds amazing. I'm so excited that they'll be talking about it. I'm going to bring Marita and Sadeqa up now. And as a reminder, I'll post all necessary links in the comment section, and you can speak to one another in the comment section or post, you know, your thoughts or ideas or any questions you have as you're watching the conversation, and Marita and Sadeqa will answer questions for the audience. So for now, let's welcome Marita and Sadeqa. Hello to you both. Thank you guys. Hello, hello.
Hello.
Hello. Marita, okay.
Okay. I'm not
here now. All right. Now we're all here. Welcome. Thank you both for joining us. I'm going to turn the program in the evening over to you all. So take it away.
Okay.
Thank you.
Hello, Sadeqa.
Hi, Marita.
Well, I have to tell you and the audience how really excited I am to be here. I have to share with everybody that two things. a couple of years ago, when you were still working on this book, we met at a party at the James River Writers Conference. And you shared with a group of us that you were working on this fantastic historical novel. And I remember I just got so excited about the possibility of reading the book. And I was excited for you as a writer, because as a writer myself and as a teacher of writing, I'm always excited when a writer is going to do something a little bit dangerous and a little bit scary. And because most of, you know, your work had been contemporary, I said, oh, this is going to be great. So when I got my copy of the book, I read it and it was like, okay, I want this book to last a long time so I never finish it, but I can't stop reading it. Mm-hmm. And I immediately emailed you and said, how can I support you? What can I do to be part of the celebration? So congratulations, girl. This is a great, great read.
Thank you so much. And I have to tell you, Marita, I remember calling you halfway through working on the novel, telling you that I was stuck. And the advice that you gave, and you said, why are you stuck? And I'm explaining it to you. And you said, Sadeqa, the story, this is not a story about slavery. It's a story about love. It's a story about family. It's a story about connections. Slavery is just the background. That's just the backdrop of the story. But at the heart of it is all these other things. Right. And just that little bit of advice that you gave me, it was very easy for me to adjust my brain. Okay. And then back into the story and really create the magic.
Well, that's why having a community as a writer is so important. You know, having another writer, having a mentor that you can call up and bounce ideas off of. So that's really proof that no writer is an island. Mm-hmm. So first, I want to just, it's a, such a fascinating story of how you found the real woman, Mary Lumpkin, that inspired this novel. So let's first talk about that.
So we moved, my family moved to the Richmond area in 2015. And in 2016, April of 2016, we had some friends from New Jersey come down to visit. We were looking for an activity where we can go outside, take the children, just something different. And we decided to walk the Richmond Slave Trail. We hadn't done any of the touristy Richmond things. And so that was where we started. And we were walking along the trail, and the trail is about 4 miles to and from. It has 17 different markers along the trail that explains what it was like for the enslaved people as they came into Richmond. Richmond was number two in the slave trade behind New Orleans. So the history here is just ripe and rich.
Right.
And we got to the marker, and it talked about the Lumpkins Jail. And it said that the jail was a punishing center and a holding cell and a place where trade had happened. And between 1844 and 1865, over 200,000 enslaved people had passed through that jail. Oh. The owner of the jail, Robert Lumpkin, was known as the bully trader. And he was said to be mean and vindictive. He was the type of person that if you wanted to make an example of your slave, you would send that slave to him and he would make that example. Well, the contradiction was that it said he was married to a Black woman, Mary Lumpkin, and that they had these 5 children together. And while he was evil in so many ways, he was compassionate and caring towards Mary and these 5 kids. Mm-hmm. And that just made the hairs on my neck stand up. I just couldn't stop thinking about Mary. What was it like for this woman? You know, was this a marriage of survival, sacrifice, convenience, love? And then what was it like for her raising these 5 children where her fellow enslaved people are being mistreated every single day? And that was really the birth of the story for me.
Right. Well, you know, people love historical novels. They take us back in time, but the best historical novels speak to the time that we're living in. So because I know there are a lot of writers in the audience tonight, let's talk a little bit about craft and technique. You know, what's the challenge in both, you know, melding fact and fiction? Because in addition to having walked that slave trail, I imagine that there was a lot of research that you had to do. And I know myself from writing books, the research can be so seductive that you can get drenched, just drowning in that, and you may not want to write. How did you meld fact and fiction in Imagining Phoebe?
There were so many interesting stories. I mean, when you start researching a subject like this, you just go in so many directions. I had to keep myself from jumping down the rabbit hole of other stories and really focus on saying, this is a Richmond story. I need to understand what happened in Richmond. I can't spend time in Charleston. While that is interesting, I need to stay over here in Richmond. So the first few months, I literally just visited plantations. I grabbed my daughters. I made them my research assistants because it's always good to teach as we go. Right. And visited plantations. I went to the Library of Virginia and I was able to find periodicals of things that had happened during that time, pictures of the Lumpkin Jail, stories on Robert Lumpkin. And I just did a lot of reading and kind of going out, smelling it, tasting it, touching it, just trying to immerse myself into it. I spent a lot of time reading slave narratives because it was important for me to create that authenticity, the way they spoke, the way they thought, what their experience was, not through the lens of a historian, because some of books are going to be, there's going to be a film there between us and the reader. And I wanted my readers to be up close and personal with Phoebe's story.
Right. So there's the historical research, but then there's this imagined character, Phoebe. Mm-hmm. How did she come to you? How did she claim you? How did she speak to you?
She came to me and her voice felt very young. And I was thinking, okay, this is an adult book, so I need to keep working with her so that I could age her a little bit in my mind. But when she first came to me, the very first scene was she was in the loom house with her mother, and her mother was saying goodnight to her. And she was whispering to her all of the recipes that she had used to heal people on the plantation because she didn't want Phoebe to forget, never wanted her to forget what they did as medicine women. And so she was whispering recipes to her. And for Phoebe, it was like a lullaby. It put her to sleep. So that was my first encounter with Phoebe. It was her and her mother and this very tender moment, her mother passing wisdom and information down to Phoebe, almost preparing her for a time when they wouldn't be together.
Right. So she's, her mother's a healer and she's a healer. One of the interesting things, you know, and when I was reading the book, I kept thinking about, you know, Beloved. Mm-hmm. I thought about Wench, you know, the novel by Dolan Perkins Valdez, all these novels about the interior lives as well as the exterior lives of enslaved Black women. And the contradiction, of course, is that she is enslaved, but she is elevated to some extent because she is the sexual concubine of the jailer. So she does have more, quote, benefits. She is in different status, but she's walking this line where she's doesn't have agency, but you do a wonderful thing in the novel where you have her act with agency. I thought it was so beautiful that when she's preparing the young women to go off to their fate, she would almost bless them spiritually. Talk about that ritual that she would do with so many of the women, which I thought was very beautiful and showed her as a healer.
Phoebe was, when she got to the actual jail, she was always a seamstress. Her mother taught her how to sew and how to heal. But when she got to the jail, she knew that she had to make herself useful. And so she inserted herself in the jailer's business and she became the woman who dressed the women who were getting ready for sale. These women were called fancy girls. They were most often mulatto women who were being sold into slavery so that they could be prostitutes. And Phoebe felt that there was nothing that she could do for them, but she wanted to do something. So she started to record their stories because she wanted to feel like they mattered, like they existed, because you know, this is a time where women didn't have a lot of privileges to begin with, and slave women had even less. And so that was her sort of paying homage to them. she prayed with each woman because that was all she could give them. You know, all she could do was pray with them and hope that they go out into the world and be okay. And it was just something that made her feel less guilty about the position that she had found herself in.
It was, I thought that was just so beautiful. And, you know, when you're writing a novel that is dealing with such a hard subject, you have to have these sort of windows that allow the reader to breathe. And I thought that those scenes provided that, because there's so much drama and terror in the relationship with the jailer. And what did you learn about the lives of enslaved Black women that you didn't know from writing this book? I think we all know, oh, well, you know, it was terrible. But what did living with this story for as long as you did teach you that was new?
That these women were smart, you know, that they were smart. They were resourceful. They knew how to use what little they had to get what they needed to get. That was the biggest lesson that I got from Phoebe, was that we come from smart people. And it started from them figuring out how to make, you know, so to speak, a dollar out of 15 cents. You know what I mean? And so they constantly had their backs against the wall, and they constantly had to figure out how to turn the corner, how to provide for them. And they sacrificed for their children the same way that we do today. I mean, their sacrifices were a lot harder in the sense that, you know, and Phoebe's mother, you know, she had to lay with the master because she knew that by being his concubine, it would put Phoebe in a better situation. All she could figure out was how to free her daughter. You know, she wasn't thinking about freedom for herself. And it's very similar to, you know, we move into certain neighborhoods because we want our kids to go to, you know, at school, or, you know, the sacrifices that we make for our children. And so we come from these smart, resourceful women who every day had to, you know, go to the line for themselves and for their family.
I love that you say that, because so often the story of our enslavement is just and only the terror, the punishment, the degradation. It's not enough of the story of our humanity and our intelligence. Mm-hmm. So, you know, so really thank you for that. Every character, you know, when you're living with them and you're writing them and they're revealing themselves to you, they all have a particular point of entry that you work very hard to go through. I know when I was writing my book about a character who had Alzheimer's disease, I had to recognize his humanity, that he had Alzheimer's disease, but he was still intelligent. He had Alzheimer's disease, but he was still creative. What obstacles did Phoebe present to you that you had to overcome, that you had to work through as a writer?
I think with Phoebe, I really had to get to know her. You know, sometimes the voices are very loud, and then when you step away for too long, you get quiet. And I had to step away from the story for a couple of months because I was helping my husband with the business that he had started. And so when I stepped back into the story, it was difficult for me and Phoebe to connect again. And for me as a writer, that is the deepest thing, is that I have to have that connection with my characters. I need to be thinking about them even when I'm not writing. When I'm falling asleep at night, I need to be thinking about them. I need to feel their presence, you know? And when it goes away, I have to work a little bit at a time every day to get them back. So that's the strongest thing for me, is how to stay connected to my characters so that I could go on the journey of writing and creating the story. And I also have to be receptive to my way is not the right way. Their way is the way, you know? And so I have to leave space for them to tell me what it is they want to do on the page. You know, I start with sort of the outline of the story so that I have a roadmap. But it's almost like a coloring page where I don't have all the colors and the details filled in. I need my relationship with Phoebe to help me fill that in and move the story forward.
Exactly. You know, one of the more interesting things also in the story was the issue of class in the community. The jailer was a man of not a lot of education, but he had wealth and he had prominence and he had power. And there are all these scenes in the book where he and his fellow jailers are sort of mimicking the lifestyle of upper class enslavers. And I thought that was so interesting. And I read a lot about slavery, but that was sort of a new wrinkle for me. Talk about why you put that in there, because that was fascinating. And he would bring the others would bring their concubine to dinner, and they would sit down and they would sort of pretend to be these rich people. That was really fascinating.
Thank you. Yeah, I learned in my research that people like Robert Lumpkin were looked at as the pariahs of society. And so the higher class would not marry their daughters to men like him. And so while he did have wealth and power and influence, he couldn't break that ceiling. And so they had to create this world for themselves. And for them, the best thing to do was to find a mulatto girl who was their property anyway, to have a family with and to, you know, build wealth with and that sort of thing. And so that was something that I had gotten a peek at during the research. And then I just kind of expanded. That dinner scene actually was, it was my imagination for the most part. You know, I got whiffs of it in the historical pages I found, but I really kind of used my imagination to create that world for them.
And what it did for me as the reader, it showed me that Lumpkin is a complicated character. You know, you even felt that in those scenes where he is forcing himself, okay, on Phoebe, that it's a mixture of raw sexual desire, but love. Mm-hmm. Okay. And that's what made him such an interesting character. He's not just a you know, ruthless, cruel enslaver only. He's that, but he's also a man who is drawn to and obsessed with this woman who is willing to both enslave, threaten, and protect.
Mm-hmm. You know, when he came to me, he came as a man with two faces. And I will say that I'm so glad that you were able to read all of those different layers, because it really, as a writer, took me a long time to get to that point. You know, the first three or four drafts, one of the notes that kept coming back from my agent was, he's too flat. I need to see more of this three-dimensional man. I need to see two faces. And so by the fifth and sixth draft is when he really started to come alive in that way on the page. But it was a struggle. He was the most difficult character for me to create in the whole book because of that, because of his two faces, because that contradiction of him being so evil and so vindictive, but being tender and compassionate and loving towards Phoebe and the children. So that was, he was a tough one. He stretched me.
Yeah. And you saw how the higher ups looked at him with contempt, yet they depended on him to, quote, break in their enslaved people. So this relationship that bound them all in this horrible institution. The quote that opens the book, which I think is really perfect, is it's a quote from William Wilberforce, who was a famed British abolitionist, correct?
Mm-hmm.
And it says, "You may choose to look the other way, but you can never say again that you didn't know." Why did you choose that?
I cannot start writing a book without framing it with a quote. That is really, like, I do all the research, I do all this stuff. And then when I sit down and type yellow wife with my name, part one, chapter one, I physically cannot write the book without framing it at least with a quote. And I flipped through many quotes. And when I read that one, I thought, yeah, you know, in our country, it is very normal for us to blot away American history, true American history. It is very easy for us to wash away the fact that the country was built on the backs of slaves and that it happened. And when you read Yellow Wife, you will never again forget that it happened. And that was what I wanted to feel as I was going into the story. And that's what I want readers to feel when they go into the story.
A couple of years ago, a prominent African-American writer said that we've had enough stories about slavery. Let's write about who we are now. Why do we continue to need stories about the enslavement of Black people?
I mean, it's the same reason why we still are reading books about, you know, the war in France and Germany and England. There is no shortage of those books, I will assure you. It's important for us to be able to tell our stories. And it's not just one story. It's not just Roots and Wench and Family by J. California Cooper and Jubilee by Margaret Walker. Those are all just snippets. You know, we're all just telling a portion of a bigger story. And I don't think that there is a shortage. Based on my research, I could probably write another, you know, 10, 20 novels talking about something very different, but still in that same time period. So there are no shortage of people who have lived through it. And so there are plenty of stories that need to be told.
And the silence has historically been so deafening that it has to be, it can be filled, as you say, forever, because the silence, and the silence actually continues to be, and whenever people want to talk about it, it's resisted furiously. What was the emotional toll for you writing this story? I remember years ago when I read Beloved, okay? And there was a point in reading the book, I got halfway through, and I simply had to put the book aside, and I put my hand on my desk, and I sobbed. I sobbed for 5 or 10 minutes, and then I wiped my eyes, and I picked the book up, and I could read. And I wondered, how did Toni Morrison live for 6 years with the story? What did it cost her, and what did she gain? And this is a beautifully written book, but I'm gonna tell you, there's some hard things in this book. So what was the emotional cost and what was the gain for you?
Well, the gain for me, you know, going into the story, I had made a commitment that I was gonna tell it the way the story came, no matter how difficult it was, because for me, it happened. And if our ancestors could live through these moments, I could surely write about it. It was my duty. I looked at it as a privilege to bring their stories to life. And so I was gonna do whatever it took. And a few of those very difficult scenes that you're mentioning that happened in the book, they actually did happen. I came across a few of them in my research, and then I fictionalized them as a way of giving a voice to these voices that had no voice. So, you know, emotionally for me, I had to continue to show up every day for the page. And I had moments, you know. I remember going to a swim meet with my youngest daughter, and I'm writing one of these difficult scenes on the side of the pool, and I'm looking around, and it's not that many people who look like me. And I'm feeling all these different emotions, you know, about the world that we live in and the world that we lived in. You know, going to the beach, I wasn't reading, you know, Beach Read. I was reading Harriet Jacobs' Incident in the Life of a Slave Girl. And so I didn't give myself a break. I was constantly immersed in this world for 3 years. And, you know, what did I gain? I gained an appreciation for our history. You know, I tell my children, in order for us to know where we're going, we need to know where we came from. And I appreciate knowing this history. Actually, it feels like I lived it to a degree at this point. And, you know, all I can do is be in appreciation and gratitude for it.
How do you, I'm going to ask you to answer this in one sentence, one quick, short sentence. What do you have to do to imagine your way under the skin of an enslaved Black woman? What do you have to do?
For me, I just had to get quiet and listen. Okay. I got to tap in. I got to listen. I just got to listen to what she's telling me in one sentence.
Okay. Okay. And that's so true. Because as you said earlier, you know, you have this idea. This is what the novel's going to be. But our characters are very real. They exist in the ethers. They exist in the world. They exist in our heart and soul. So they have a say too. This is a co-chairmanship. We're not the only boss. So I think that that's true. And they may take a while. It may take them a while to know what the story is, mm-hmm. so that they can tell it to you. Mm-hmm. Definitely. Go ahead.
I was going to say, I try and sometimes, and this is what kind of gets me out of my own head and out of my own way. I tell myself that I'm just the conduit. And I don't have to judge the work as it comes through me. And I don't have to perfect it. I just have to get it down.
Were there one or two books? I know, you know, you read a lot, but were there any books that were particularly helpful that once you read those books, oh, you just went to another level in your understanding of what you had to do?
50 Years a Slave by Charles Ball was one that really, really touched me. I mean, it was him telling the story. It felt very accurate. It was another level of what enslaved people went through that I hadn't known. He had escaped twice. And so he had been on different plantations, and the way he described the different masters and the way that, you know, the way that even Black people were with each other on this plantation, his story really linked a lot to Yellow Wife.
And say the title again.
It's called 50 Years a Slave by Charles Ball.
Okay, 50 Years a Slave. Mm-hmm. Now, you're living in Virginia. And now tell the story also about what happened to the land that she was bequeathed, because that's the most redemptive part of this whole, the real story.
And that was the cinch for me. Once I had come upon that bit of history, I thought, I have to write this story. So Mary Lumpkin, when Robert Lumpkin died, first of all, before he died, the Civil War had come, slavery had ended, and he didn't want to let go of his fortune. So he grabbed 50 slaves and he went to the bus depot and tried to get on the bus with on the train with them. I'm sorry, the train depot, and tried to get on the train with them and take them down south so he could sell them. Well, he was stopped at the train station. There was not enough room, thank goodness, on the train. They wouldn't let him go. And then the army came and broke everything up and let the people go. So he died of a broken heart. He died of, I think it was cholera. But when he died, in his will, he said, I leave all of my property and my funds to my yellow wife. And he was referring to Mary Lumpkin. That is where I got the title from the book, for the book. Mary Lumpkin then went into, she was walking around Richmond and she overheard a conversation about someone looking to rent space so that he could teach freedmen how to read and write. And the man's name was Nathaniel Culver. And so she leased the Lumpkin's jail to him and he brought his students in. Now the Lumpkin's jail was referred to as the devil's half acre because it was such a horrific place to be. Well, under Nathaniel Culver, he turned it into a school. The chains were removed from the floor and then people start calling it God's half acre. And so that was Mary Lumpkin redeeming whatever, her hands had to get dirty in this situation. But that was her redeeming herself by turning it over to him. That school changed names a few times, changed locations, but it later becomes Virginia Union University, which is still one of the first historical Black colleges and still in Richmond today. And when I got that piece of information, I thought there's no way I have to tell this story.
Well, I it sounds like there needs to be a statue to Mary Lumpkin in Richmond.
Hmm. We have one now Maggie Lena Walker.
I've seen it.
Yes, but yes, we need more for sure.
Now, so you're in the heart of Dixie. I taught at Virginia Commonwealth University for several years, and Richmond was a conundrum. Monument Avenue, you know, it was really strange. So you're in the heart of pulling down the statues, the debate about these monuments, and talk about, you know, what it's meant for you to live in Richmond and to be in the midst of that fervor as you are finishing up this book.
You know, coming from, you know, I always say I came from North because I grew up in Philadelphia. I went to college in New York City. I lived in New Jersey. My kids were born there. So when I first got to Richmond, I just thought Monument Avenue and all of that was just really strange and weird. It was very uncomfortable, you know, except for our tennis player, Arthur Ashe. That was the only beautiful statue.
For those who don't know, Monument Avenue is this long avenue in a part of Richmond that is a very wealthy part of the city. And it had been populated by statues of Confederate generals. And then after Arthur Ashe's death, I think, because Arthur Ashe was born there, they put a statue to him. But it always looks so weird. Mm-hmm. Arthur Ashe beside Robert E. Lee. Okay, come on.
Right. Yeah. So it was always kind of a weird thing for us. And I would say, you know, when they decided to take the monuments down, it had happened after people had already kind of gone through the streets and marked it up. Like when I went to see the statue prior to them taking it down, it was completely marked up. They had surrounded the area with Black Lives Matter, and they had pictures of Black people who had been shot by the police or killed by the police, and they kind of made a shrine for them. I have to say that made a very ugly situation quite beautiful when you got to see, you know, what we changed it to, you know, for us. But it was a very strange situation for me because I'm not from Virginia, you know. In order to experience all that, it was definitely a historical moment.
Yeah. Let's now talk about your journey as a writer. You know, how did you decide I'm going to write? You worked in publishing for a while, and then when did you decide, okay, I'm not going to just promote Amy Tan and all these people, I'm going to write books like they do? What happened?
I was working at Scholastic. I was a theater major in college, so I was already kind of writing plays, and I had gotten into the poetry scene, you know, in New York City in the 90s. It was all about New Eurekan Cafe and writing poems and performing. So it really spoke to all of my sides. I started taking screenplay writing classes at the Frederick Douglass Creative Center. So I was dipping my toe in a bunch of things. But when I got into publishing, I realized my first love had always been books. I was the girl who went to the library once a week and checked out 7 books and read one a day. So, you know, I realized that my heart had always been into writing, and being in a publishing house, being surrounded by books all the time, it started to get my juices flowing. And at my first job is where I started my very first novel. That novel never saw the light of day, but it was my second novel that I'd started, Love in a Carry-On Bag, that I nurtured, you know, from job to job. I left Scholastic and I went to Putnam, which was adult publishing. And so I had the opportunity to pick the brain of writers. B.B. Moore Campbell was one of my authors. And I remember spending time asking her questions, you know, getting her story. What, you know, where did you start? I know one of the things she told me was that her very first manuscript, she was at the University of Pittsburgh and she left it on the bus.
Oh.
And she had to start over because this was not a computer era. She typewrote it, you know, she used a typewriter for that first manuscript. And so it was in collecting their stories and their inspiration that I thought, hey, I could do this. And so I started penning that first novel. I wrote on the way in. I lived in New Jersey at the time. So I wrote on the train every day at 4:00. I closed my office. I put all my notes into the computer. I printed it. I had to run to the printer because I didn't want anybody to know I was writing a book. And I had to snatch it up before someone else saw what was going on. Right. And the way home, I edited it. And I did that for years. You know, I just kept working that same story. And my first book took 10 years, which I know it feels and sounds like a long time, but for me, it's what I needed to learn how to write.
Now, were you taking classes or were you just writing on your own?
I was taking classes. So I think you and I met. I was already working on my second novel. So Marita was my amazing teachers, but I was taking classes in New Jersey and New York consistently. Like I would just enroll from one workshop to the next. I would stay with one teacher for a while. If it was a teacher who I loved their book, I would take their class, but I was constantly in a place of learning.
Right. And the reason I ask that is because that's so important. I'm doing many things. I'm writing books and I'm teaching classes and I'm doing literary consulting. And very often people will ask me to evaluate their manuscripts. And I'm always utterly amazed at the number of people who will give me a manuscript of significant length. And when I ask them, had they ever taken a class? They hadn't taken a single class. They had spent 3 years totally alone just writing. Now, on the one hand, I say, look, that's amazing, the dedication that that takes. So I always take my hat off to that because many people want to write but can't write. These people write, can't stop. It's just that they never think to be in community and that the process of writing would be even more satisfying, actually, if they were in community. Talk about how important it is to be in community.
Yeah, particularly when you're starting off, it's a little bit more challenging for me now to be in community. But when I was first starting, you know, that first book, having people who I can bounce ideas off of, you know, forming small writing circles where you have just a couple of people and you're sharing portions of your manuscripts and you're getting feedback, you know, having a teacher that you trust, someone who's not only listening and helping you with your story, but giving you tips, you know? I had not known what an aphorism was until I took a class. But one of the classes I took, my teacher made us do it every single class was take a cliche and make it fresh. You know, I would, and I do that in my books. I always, when I hit a cliche, I think, okay, wait, I need to make this fresh. You know, it's not enough to say, you know, whatever the, you know, whatever it is, make it fresh. And so you learn tips along the way and having other writers, you know, writing is a lonely thing because you spend so much time in your head and at your computer. So having a community is really, really important.
And, you know, for Black writers and writers of color, you know, you attended Kimbelio, you attended Hurston Wright. There's also Voices of Our Nation, which is a writer's workshop for writers of color, Black, Latinx, Asian, as well as hundreds of writing workshops all around the country. And they've done a great job of adapting to the new world we are in, the new virtual world. So there's so much support out there for writers if they will take advantage of it. What's your advice? What's the one thing writers need to know to stay the course?
The biggest thing for me is have a schedule. Be intentional about your writing. One of my early teachers said, if you just wrote 10 minutes before bed every day, exactly, you know it, 10 minutes is 20 minutes, 20 minutes is 45, and then you're writing 2 hours a day. Just be intentional about your writing. You know, I actually have a distraction problem. So I have to write down my start and my end time so that I could reach whatever my quota is. For today, my quota was 3 hours. And my kids are home, they're virtual school, so they want to pop in all day long. So when they pop in, I have to hit in on my time, talk to them, and then go back to it, you know? But you have to be intentional about creating that space for yourself. I really need to put a lock on my door so they could stop popping in. But you need to be intentional. Schedule your writing time the same way you would a doctor's appointment. And don't give up. It is not easy. It is not easy being a writer. It's not easy, but that doesn't mean you're not supposed to do it.
Exactly. And well, good writing isn't supposed to be easy. It's supposed to be challenging. And also, you don't know what you're writing. That's why you're writing it. You're writing to find out what you're writing. So all of the natural, what I will tell students when they will, you know, oh, this is so frustrating. Oh, that's called writing. That's called writing. So at this point, I think that we can open up if there are any questions from the audience. Diana, are there any? I don't see any questions.
Hi. You all are getting a lot of kudos. I'm going to post some of them up just so you all can see. I don't see any questions yet, but we'll do a last call.
I would, if we don't have any questions, I would like to ask Sadeqa to read a little bit. We had talked about that earlier. I think it'd be great if the audience, those who have not yet bought the book, got a taste of your writing.
Absolutely. I'll just start right at the beginning and just read the opening scene. So this is Yellow Wife and chapter one. The Bell Plantation. Mama believed that the full moon was the most fertile night of the month, and that everything she touched held God's power. Each full moon, she dragged me out in the middle of the night with her to hunt for roots, plants, seedlings, and rare blossoms to use for healing. I did not understand why God's power could not be found during daylight hours. And as I trudged behind her, the March cold overwhelmed me. Even my thick wool shawl was no match against the country freeze. Fear of the woods made my feet clumsy, and I tripped over falling sticks, scratched my shins on the spiky brush, and bumped my head on low hanging branches. Mama, on the other hand, moved with skill and confidence, like the earth parted a path and presented the way for her. Even in the dark, she knew where to stop for herbs and how to avoid the dangerous ones. We had only a small lantern to guide us. And when I asked how she knew where things grew, she responded, "My gut be my light." We slipped through the thicket, past the drafty cabins where the field hands slept on pallets stuffed with hay and husk. I heard dry coughs and a low whine from a hungry baby. Farther down toward the James River, we traveled through the clearing where we met on Sunday for church. Then over the hill along the side of the cemetery, peppered with sticks to honor our dead. As we traveled deeper into the woods of the plantation, the thick forest blocked the light of the moon. I could hear the growls and grunts of unseen animals and fretted over running into hungry raccoons or red foxes or stepping on a poisonous snake. I tried to clear the worry from my mind as the land flattened out, but then something pricked my ankle. Before I could call out, Mama stopped suddenly and reached for my hand. "This here is a black walnut tree. Grow deep in the woods, so you gotta know where to look. Cure for most everything. Ever unsure, come seek this tree." Mama handed me the lantern, then pulled a blade from a satchel and severed a piece of bark. She brought it to her nose, then ran a tongue along the inside of it. Husk stains anything it touch. After we make a tea for Rachel, rest we use to dye those sheets for the nursery. Just hoping we ain't too late to save that girl. Mama reached into her bag and pulled out a red ribbon. "Gone and mark it, so it'll be easy to find when you come without me." I reached up and tied the ribbon on a skinny twig, knowing I had no intention of roaming these woods without my mama. We stopped at the sick house on our way back home. That morning, Rachel, the house servant, had been moved from the big house to the sick room on account of her high fever. Even though Master Jacob's wife, Mrs. Delfina, knew Mama worked plants better than anybody, she refused to bring her up to the house to tend to Rachel when she got fever with lockjaw. Rachel grew up on Mrs. Delfina's family plantation and came with her to Master Jacob's as a wedding gift from her mother. Since Mrs. Delfina looked down on Mama's medicine, she called in a white doctor for Rachel, which Mama said was a waste of good money. He ain't know nothing about doctor and no field hands. And Mama was right. Now that the white medicine had failed, Mrs. Delfina had no choice but to move Rachel to the sick house. When we entered the room, even I could look at Rachel's pale body and see death coming for her. "You ready to hot water?" Mama asked the sick nurse, who nodded her head and pointed to the boiling pot. Mama reached into her sack and pulled out the bark and leaves from the black walnut tree. Then she pinched off a sprig of snake root and crushed up the stems. "Let it steep about an hour, then make a sip every time she opened her eyes. If she make it through the night, there'll be hope." Mama removed a few balms and poultices from her medicine satchel for the other patients, then gently pressed Rachel's forehead with the palm of her hand and whispered, "Lord, look on Rachel with eyes of mercy. Restore her to wholeness and strength. Thy will be done."
When I read that, I felt that I was totally in the woods with them. I could feel the prick of the leaves. I could smell the night air. You know, that's the kind of writing that just transports the reader and makes it impossible for the reader to resist the story. Great job.
Thank you.
I think we have a couple of questions. Diana?
Melanie said, "Can I talk about getting an agent?"
Oh, yeah.
My first agent, I worked in publishing. So my very first agent, I had actually met her because I was, I had known her assistant, and she had looked at my work and decided to take me on, but she wasn't able to sell my book. And so I ended up self-publishing my first book. My editor, who edited Love in a Carry-On Bag, she worked with me on Love in a Carry-On Bag. And when I finished Second House from the Corner, she was also my editor on that book as well. And I finally said to her, "You probably should just be my agent. Nobody cares about my work as much as you," because she and I had such a close relationship at this point. We had worked on two books together. And it was at the time where she was kind of ready to transition into agenting. And so she then became my agent.
Yeah, and there are a lot of new ways to find agents. I mean, a lot of people are finding agents on Twitter these days. Just a whole lot of new ways. Tyrone, when you are in the revision process, how do you know when your manuscript is a finished product? When do you know to let it go?
You might want to answer this too, Marita. For me, it's when I don't have anything else left to say. I don't think I can make it any better. And then I send it to my agent, and then she and I do a draft together. She gives me comments, and then I go back into the story. That's usually my process.
I know a story is finished when I've gone all the places in the story that I did not want to go, told myself I would never go, and am recovering from having gone there. Thank you so much for this wonderful gift. I purchased a signed copy of Yellow Wife from Words Bookstore in New Jersey. I was looking forward to this event all day. Please talk about voice and vernacular. That's interesting because, you know, I noticed that, you know, there's this feeling that if you're writing about enslaved people, they talked in a way that showed that they did not have command of the English language. But in actuality, enslaved people talked pretty much normally. They didn't talk these and those and, you know, so, and I noticed in the book, you adhere to that.
Yeah, it was, you know, it was something that I struggled with, to be honest, in the beginning, was to get the language down. I looked back on the way Zora Neale Hurston wrote "Their Eyes Were Watching God." And then I looked at the way Dolan Perkin Valdez wrote "Wench." And I thought, okay, these are two very different sides of the spectrum. Where does Yellow Wife fit into it? So getting the language and the dialect and getting that down, that did take a bit of time for me to get it. And every draft, you know, it was trimmed or fixed. And then when it got through the editing process, it was tightened up. But it was definitely a process for me to get that language down and make it sound authentic and easy for the reader to read.
Right. Kalisha? Can you explain how or why you write across genre? fitting yourself to the stories and characters that come rather than making them fit you, from romance to domestic and now to historical fiction?
It wasn't anything that was intentional, really. My first novel, Love in a Carry-On Bag, it came to me because I knew that I loved a good love story. I was in a long distance relationship with my husband, and my early writing teacher said, write what you know and then fictionalize it. And trust that once you take characters that you think you know and put them down on the page, they'll start to speak to you and move in a way that will create really good fiction. So that was kind of the rule that I lived by. The story actually has to do something to me. Like for Second House from the Corner, my grandmother was a really good storyteller. So she was always telling me stories about people in our family and things that had happened. And I was storing all that information. And then I was also living this life where I was this mom of three very small children. I was home with them. I was feeling like I was drowning in my skin, and I needed some place to put that. And so it is very therapeutic for me to put myself into the story and then kind of fictionalize it. And so it really is like, what am I going through? What's the world going through? What do I feel inspired by? What's kind of tapping me on the shoulder? And that's really how I get from book to book.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
How about you, Marita?
Well, I write, I go back and forth between fiction and nonfiction. I write nonfiction because I want to dialogue with things that are happening in the world. I want to become part of the public discourse. And so I won't write a letter to the editor. I'll write a book. Okay. And I write fiction because I don't choose my novels. My novels literally choose me. I get literally possessed. So people think that it's so easy. Oh, what's your next novel going to be? I have no idea. I haven't gotten my assignment from God yet. Okay. Harina, love your work, was introduced to your work starting from Love in a Carry-On Bag, wondering how you feel about optioning your work for the screen. Would you trust a director to tell your stories correctly? Hell yeah. No.
Call them. I think it's every writer's dream to see their book in movie form or a series form or something. And I'm definitely one of those. Yes.
Mm-hmm. Yes, exactly. Jacqueline, you like to start with a quote. What is your process for choosing a quote? How do you know that is the quote you should choose?
I feel my way through it. It's funny because if I have an idea, like particularly for Yellow Wife, I think I probably put in the Google search or the Goodreads. Goodreads has a lot of quotes. And so I might put in like a catchword, and then those catchwords will lead me to certain people, and then those people will lead me to the quote. And so it's definitely a process. It's a feeling. I have to kind of feel my way through it. And when I get the right quote, it's like a feeling of satisfaction that comes over me that says, yes, that's what I was trying to say.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Helena, what was the hardest part to write, beginning, middle, or end?
I would say middle is always where I struggle. I've been to writers' workshops where they call it the squishy middle. It's like, I know where the story starts. I know what I'm trying to say, but going through the middle sometimes feels like I'm trudging through the snow with no snow boots or something. Like, that's always the trickiest part for me. For Yellow Wife, the ending too, I didn't really know exactly how it was going to end until I got there. And usually I have a strong idea, but for Yellow Wife, I really didn't know until I got to the end.
And the thing about the middle is that the middle is the story. The middle is the essence of the story. The middle is the day-to-day minutia, the little tiny things where the characters are living out their lives, 9 to 5, 6 a.m. to 9 a.m., and you have to figure out, how do I fill this up? It's called life. Mm-hmm. The middle is life. Mm-hmm. Lorraine, Sadeqa, when you were writing Yellow Wife, how often did you have a God moment of muses?
Every day. That's when I know I'm in the right spot. You know, sometimes every day when I'm writing, I have God moments. There's something that happens to my body. It's like my eyes go hooded. I feel this energy that comes over me. Yesterday, I was in that space and my daughter came in and she's looking at me and she's like, "Mommy, what's wrong with you?" I said, "If you talk to me right now, you're going to break my connection with my character. Please leave," because I'm there. I'm connected. And it's God who's giving me the story. You know, God is all the characters. So it's an everyday occurrence.
Mm-hmm. Marjorie, has your interest in theater and performing helped your creation of characters and storytelling?
Writing is like method acting for me. You know, you have to embody the character, body, soul, speech, mannerisms, touch, all of that. So I would definitely say that it's been a plus for me.
Brenda, how does it feel to have your work out in the world?
Like this.
Exactly. I wanted to ask you, you know, we don't celebrate ourselves as writers enough. You know, we're always complaining, how will I start the book? Then once we finished it, oh my God, will the book sell? You know, we're always worried. How have you celebrated yourself?
Wow, Marita, you just called me all the... blame everything on COVID, you know? Oh, we can't go out. I shouldn't do this. I shouldn't do that. But I have not celebrated myself at all. So that is something.
Oh, yes. You got to find a way. When I was writing my last novel, I would write a draft, send it to my agent, and then I would figure out something. I remember I finished a really good draft, sent it to my agent, and I bought tickets for the Universal Circus.
Oh, I love that circus.
And just went with my husband to the circus.
Uh-huh.
And just for a couple of weeks, let my agent read it and then got back in it. But I really think it's important that we celebrate ourselves. I mean, because we're so neurotic, we're so worried, we're so tense. And this thing that we're doing is really so amazing. And like I told you, I'm not going to tell everything, but like I told you, you just brought a book into the world, girl. You birthed a book. You birthed a world. Yeah. So don't worry about, you ain't got time for what people say. You birthed a book. The last question, what do you do to take care of yourself? Now, you said you haven't celebrated, but how do you self-care?
I run.
Okay.
I ran today 4 miles. I am in a hiking group in Richmond. And
great.
We hike twice a month or so. And I've even gotten my husband into hiking. So I'll drag him out on the trail with me. That's kind of the way we've been dating in COVID.
Great.
Is hiking. So physical activity. I meditate every day.
Me too.
Part of my process. I have to meditate every day. I wish I can tell you that I practice yoga often because my body is screaming for it and I have not been making the time. So really that could just be a gift, is for me to give myself some hot yoga, you know? Because that always makes me feel really good.
Well, if you're walking, you know, there's a saying that your two legs are your doctor. So walking is good enough. Mm-hmm. This has been great, Sadeqa, and I'm so happy for you. So proud of this book. And I know you're going to sell a lot of books after this conversation.
Thank you. It's been so great to be here. And then also, Marita, we didn't even talk about the fact that you were my teacher. So like you were like one of my teachers back on my second novel, you know, and you pushed me, you stretched me, you scared me. But here I stand, living to tell the tale. So thank you.
We were talking earlier that you got mad with me, but I said, that's okay. You're supposed to be mad with me. Just do it.
And I did. I did. And this is the result of it. So thank you.
My pleasure. My pleasure. Diana?
Yes, that was an amazing, awesome discussion. Thank you both for joining us. I know when you go back, see all the comments and kudos that people have shared with you. Thank you for joining us. Do you all have any last words you want to share with us? Any upcoming events that you want to tell people about?
Well, I do want to invite the audience to a creative conversation to celebrate Women's History Month that I'm hosting on Saturday, March 20th. I'm going to have six amazing Black women writers Kalisha Buchanan, Zelda Lockhart, Athena Dixon, Deneen Brown, who's a writer for the Washington Post and who's doing a documentary on the Tulsa Massacre, Felicia Pride, who writes for Queen Sugar and Grey's Anatomy, and Imani Perry, who wrote the beautiful book, Looking for Lorraine. So those six amazing writers, we're gonna be talking about the women who've inspired us, the writers who've inspired us. And if you wanna get an invitation to that, visit my website, maritagolda.com, join my email list.
Your email list, that's good, Marita.
My email list.
Awesome. Just when you have anything. Yes. Okay. Yes. And I posted Marita's website in the chat, but also your mailing list link has also been posted in the comments. So encourage, and I'll post it on the screen, encouraging people to join that, to sign up for that. Sadeqa, do you have anything you want to share? Any last words?
Yeah, everything is on my website. If you go to SadeqaJohnson.net, my events is actually on the first page of the website. So just scroll down a little bit. I think I need to move my events up, but scroll down a little bit. Trust me, they're down there. So all of my events are there. I'm really getting into Instagram lately, Diana. So find me on Instagram.
I've finally
come into the present with everybody else. So my IG handle is at Sadeqa Says, and you could also find me on Twitter. Same.
Awesome. And Diana, I do want to thank you for this. Libraries are so important. They play such an important role in our lives. I mean, they were crucial in my life in childhood, and I'll be so glad when I can go back to the library. Mm-hmm. After, you know, this is over. So thank you for hanging in there with the library.
Yes, thank you. Thank you so much for joining us. You know, Sadeqa, I've watched you just grow as a writer and as a, you know, and Marita, I took classes with you as well. So I can just vouch for the goodness and awesomeness of both of these women, writing wise and just in general as people. So thank you for joining us, and we hope you can come back for another event.
And this was a pajama party.
Yes, it was. It was. So thank you both. Thank you both.
Okay. Bye bye.
So we want to thank Marita and Sadeqa for joining us. We hope that you all have enjoyed tonight's program. Please visit our website, dclibrary.org, to see what other Women's History Month events we are having throughout the month of March. I just want to invite people on March 24th. I will be hosting an event with Tamara Winfrey Harris, who is the who has authored the book Dear Black Girl, letters that were written to younger Black women by adult Black women. And we'll have teens from our teen council who will join us in the conversation. So it'll be an awesome event. And then our second Our City, Our Stories event will be on Monday, March 29th. I'm calling it the ABCs of the ANC, and we will have a representative from the ANC join us to talk about the ANC, what it is, what should your ANC commissioner be doing? If you want to run for ANC commissioner, how do you do it? Just the ins and outs of all of that. So we hope you can join us for either one of those events or any of our virtual events. Thank you and have a wonderful evening.